depends on what kind of guy he is.
Yeah.
I'll open the study of the 23rd. 24th. 24th. I'm a day behind, so I'll open the June 24th meeting of the Reading Conservation Commission. First on the agenda is 87 Avalon Road, McMullen. It's an RDA. Someone here for... Okay. If you'd like to state your name and present your project.
Good evening. My name is Steve Bazek. I'm the architect for Julia and Brian McMullen, 87 Avalon. As you can see in our application, our proposal is twofold. One, we're asking for the removal of an existing deck to be built, rebuilt, in relatively the same location. We are willing to forfeit about 40% of the deck size in favor of conservation to get an additional 1 foot in depth on the deck. The footings and foundation system will remain in exactly the same place. We do have to remove the existing ones.
I'm sorry, if you don't mind if I interrupt.
No, no problem.
You said the footing and foundation would stay in the same place?
The footings of the deck will go back in exactly the same location, so meaning they will not get any closer to the conservation property than they are today.
So then this additional foot is going to be cantilevered?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Sorry to interrupt.
No, no problem. So we're looking for an additional 1 foot that is cantilevered, exactly. The footings do have to be removed. The existing ones are not anywhere near meeting code, so the new ones will go in. The second part of the proposal is above the garage, there is a former deck screened in porch that became living space that is in somewhat in deterioration. It has water management issues. We're looking to remove that part and possibly part of the supporting structure that is the garage below and rebuild it to its existing size and then add an additional floor above. But that would remain exactly the same outline or footprint, if you will, in relationship to the existing conditions.
Okay. Rebecca did a site visit, is that correct?
That is correct.
With the snow on the ground?
4 inches. 82 degrees. Clear. Sorry, that was...
That's okay.
Uh-huh. I took a look at the wetlands, and in most locations there was wetland vegetation, except I think at flags 8A or 7A, and that is lawned area. And in back of that, there's a very, what I call a koi pool or something like that. It's not a pool that you swim in. It's, you know, something for
fish
frogs. Yeah.
With no fish.
Is it lined or is it?
It's lined. It has like a plastic lining that owners before us put it in. We actually don't have any fish right now.
There are no fish in there?
No, right now.
And I observed the deck that was seemed to be in poor condition.
And it's primarily lawn between the existing deck and the wetland flags?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, any questions from the commissioners?
The other point I just want to make is we're going to relocate the stairs to take circulation as far away from the conservation property as possible also.
Mr. Chairman, I would suggest that since they're moving 6 feet further from the wetland, even though they're within 25 feet, that a variance is not required.
I tend to agree.
And particularly with the cantilevering, since there's no disturbance.
There's no disturbance.
The 25
there, right.
Zone. So I don't see the need for a variance.
Does anybody else on the commission, I guess, what's the commission's feeling about that?
Makes sense to me.
I would concur.
Okay. Any other comments from the commission? I'll entertain a motion for a negative determination.
Second that.
Okay, all in favor?
All right.
Negative is good. That means you don't have to do anything further.
Is that both conditions or just the deck for both conditions?
Both.
I think the application is for both.
As submitted. It's approved as submitted.
Great,
thank you.
Thank you, have a good evening.
I do believe we are ahead of schedule.
Let me know if you guys want to sign that.
So you have that prepared, is that correct?
I do.
We can sign it.
Does it call for any...
I have to modify the cantilevering, and it does not call for any bounds. It's an RDA. It's not usually what we do.
Thank you.
I mean, the bounds would be under the deck. I don't think we want the bounds.
We've modified that in the past. If it was a notice of intent, I would have put it in there because you guys just modified, put them on the two property lines in one additional spot.
It's off Luanas Drive. Off of West Street.
I apologize, Chuck. You said you didn't have one general way prepared, or you did?
I do.
You do?
It's just a denial, or it's just a positive determination.
Positive determination.
And we're just signing it.
All right,
so if you want to go ahead.
Why don't we do that?
Did you receive any application for this?
George Danis is going to come in at some point. At least I was told that, and he has something to talk to the commission about. It was too late to put it on the agenda, so he's coming in as citizens open forum. So.
Okay.
While we're waiting for 7:10, I'd like to think we should welcome our new member.
Yes,
thank you.
Thank him for
joining,
for his volunteering and his service.
Excited to be a part of the commission. I'm bored.
Glad to have you.
And your background is geology, hydrogeology, or both?
Civil engineering.
Oh.
So I'm actually a geotechnical engineer.
All right. Has most of your work been with buildings or hazardous waste cleanup?
It's actually a little bit of a mix. Actually, a lot of it's been water resources, dams and levees.
Oh, wow.
A lot of excavation support, vertical construction, highway bridges.
Great.
Chuck, did you? Okay. I didn't know if you were still looking for it or... All right, it got stuck between...
Yeah, when you take things out of order, I have this set up for the meeting. So when you take them out of order, I have to start looking.
Yeah, I got to throw a monkey wrench into that process.
But that's... Don't worry.
All right, I think... Let's see. Nope, we're still not ready. How about the Boston Gas?
That's prepared.
That's just a sign, because we had a negative determination for that, so.
Okay. Oh, this is a positive determination. Did Chuck, they file what?
They didn't file. They were hot to file.
No, I meant for this RDA. General way.
Did they file? I don't understand you. You said
they submitted an RDA.
They did.
And how much did they pay with that?
Just a regular amount. It's $150. So you're signing Form 2 of that RDA that they submitted.
What I'm wondering is if we could apply the $150 if they come in with the NOI.
Yeah, let's pump that $470,000 we gave back to $471,000.
No, I think that's the process. I think, you know. If someone submits an RDA, they pay the fee, and then if they have to submit a notice of intent, they pay the notice of intent fee.
Right.
I can update you on if there's still time.
Well, yeah, we're waiting for that since you're going through it, so.
So I got an email from John Dick over at Hancock, and he suggested that he redid the fees, but he didn't include the verification of the wetland line, so that's minus that amount, and the fees came to $471,000. And he suggests that they will pay 1% of that total
just
fee.
Just a 1% with no reason for 1% as opposed to 1.5 or anything?
He just said that was reasonable, in his opinion. This is $4,714.
So we'll discuss that.
Said the he's going to send an email, but it's laid out in the email. And I think he based it on a construction cost of under 50,000.
I thought it was 50,000.
What do you say?
I said under 50.
Oh, under. I thought you said,
yeah.
Under
50. Okay, it being 7:10 or after 7:10. We're going to continue with the next item on the agenda. 258 Lowell Street, Marshawn. It's RDA 2015-12. Is there someone here to represent? Great.
I'm Dave Marshawn. I'm the sole owner of that parcel. And thank you for meeting with me and Chuck for getting this on the table. Our project is to put in a patio that's going to be used for multi-purposes. Currently, the area is covered by lawn, and we'd like to put a 27-square-foot patio there. The southern border of this patio would be about 10 feet from our fence, and beyond the fence is wetlands, and where we've measured the sensitive plants to wetlands, and that includes cattail and skunk cabbage. The area closest to the multi-purpose patio is about 25 feet to that location. There would be no cement involved in construction. The idea is to level the lawn off. That has begun. And then we would add sand and gravel to that and then put 6 by 9 inch pavers on the surface. And it would be a permeable surface. The only concrete would be used to put in the post for the hoop, which would be about 54 feet from the fence and another 10, 15 feet to the wetlands. We knew that there would be some obstacles beneath the surface based on planting in the area. There is, in fact, some asphalt scattered about in there. It would have been an old surface. What we weren't aware of is that there's an old cobblestone pavement there.
Wow.
And they're closely spaced, and so together those are fairly impermeable. And the asphalt in places looks like it's degrading, and there's a little oil residue at the base.
So there's cobblestone and then asphalt over the cobblestone?
Yeah, I think what probably it was is a road that has some swales in it, so they filled in the lower areas with asphalt, because the asphalt's not continuous, and it's just patchy places. So the idea would be to remove all that stuff, which is not natural, and put in clean fill, and put in these permeable pavers. And it would be, as I said, used for basketball, but other purposes.
Well, I see on the plan that it's a right-of-way.
Yep, so we have two lots.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Probably where it came from.
Yeah. Now, there's one other thing I wanted to mention, and I'm not sure if we've got a resolution on it. We called DigSafe before we did anything on June 1st, and they said there's a 6-inch, potentially a 6-inch gas line that terminates just to the north of where we want to put
really?
Yeah, the hoop. And so then we said, that, well, that's odd, and we called back when we said, what does this really mean? And they said, well, it should be there, but we're not sure. We're not sure if it's active or not. We'll send somebody out. So we got somebody to come out after talking to Chuck, and they were on the way, and they said, well, can you tell us where the pipe is? And I said, well, it's marked. And they said, well, we have to see the exposed pipe in order to measure whether it's active. There's another guy who comes in and looks for buried pipes. So we've been trying to contact him the last week to get this other guy in to look at the buried pipe. But in making these phone calls, the people we've been talking to are saying, well, I don't think it's active. We don't have service in that area. You know, we don't really know if there's even a pipe there. So we did not see it when we were digging in the area with our shovels. So it's an unknown right now.
At least you're aware that it may be there.
Right. Yeah, and we know where it should terminate based on some records that National Grid had.
Okay. All right. And Rebecca, did you visit this site as well?
I visited this site.
Okay.
Almost got rear-ended getting in the driveway.
That's Lowell Street.
It's tough, yeah. I observed wetlands. I think they were cattail, sensitive ferns, skunk cabbage, jewelweed, and dogwood. In particular, right at the fence line, which is the west side of the property line, right in back. It's all landscaped up to the fence, and then right beyond the fence is wetland, at least to the south. As you get further to the north, I think it moves a little further back. And I observed a wooden shed, and the earth was disturbed. It was opened up. There was a dirt pile closest to the shed and bobcat there. And I did see the cobblestones. I didn't really see the asphalt.
So this depiction on the map of the wet area here is fairly accurate? Or?
I think it is, yeah.
Yeah.
I think, Chuck, you went out and took a look at that area.
So you think...
Where's the fence?
Fence is
right on the property line?
Yeah, right at the property line. Sorry.
So it is approximately 25 feet from the wetland?
Yes.
Now that shed shown on the plan, that's existing, is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
And what's the foundation for the shed?
It's just blocks, cobblestone blocks.
Commission have any additional questions, or it's existing lawn, conversion of existing lawn, really.
There's a shed between
the sheds
shed
there.
And fence between the
fence
that
is
and
there.
So just to make sure I understand what's going to happen, the existing lawn is pretty much already excavated.
Yes.
And you've gotten down to cobblestone.
About 8 to 10 inches below the surface, we've hit cobblestone.
And you're going to remove those cobblestones, right?
Right.
And then you're going to put in granular fill?
Yes. Yep.
And then pavers over the granular,
right.
Granular fill?
Right.
And what are you going to do with the cobblestones?
What are we going to do with the cobblestones? Well, I do a lot of landscaping, so I thought maybe I have a stone wall on the other side of the property, and right now it's just field stone, but it might be nice to use those. I'd like to reuse them in some way.
Are those cobblestones more like semi-chipped shaped granite or just field stones?
No, they look like the kind you see in Boston. So there's a smooth surface on the top, and they're basically about 8 inches, maybe 10 inches horizontally, maybe 12 to 15 deep. So they're kind of stacked like this.
Wow.
Yeah. I have no idea. I searched on a lot of maps. I just looked at that one there to see if I could see any, you know, problems.
I don't think I've ever seen a cobblestone street in Reading, but I can remember.
It's right there. I don't know if you've ever priced cobblestones, but they're pretty expensive. So.
Yes,
right.
I know.
Yeah. So I'll entertain a motion for a negative determination.
Second.
There's some second.
All in favor? You're all set?
Okay, great. Thank you.
You have that, Chuck?
I do.
So, how many cobblestones do you think they are? Over 100?
You know, I don't know how extensive they are, because we get back to bobcats pushing things, and so some of the air is piled up. But where it's exposed down, they're side by side, so I think I've seen maybe 30 already.
Wow.
So there could be a couple hundred, you know? Yeah.
Probably going all the way to Lowell.
if you want, when I get them, I'll show you guys the picture.
No, I'm just curious.
Okay.
Just curious.
All right, thank you.
Wow.
It was right away. It looked like it was a street, but a street going into the wet area.
Probably the landfill. Just
is
like the
there?
Back bay.
Hey.
Either that or it was the compost area back then.
I don't think they had a compost here. That would be Spectacle Island.
Yeah. Okay, it is 7:20. What do you have for us, Chuck, on the enforcement closeout?
I don't have anything. You were supposed to go to 29 Gavin Circle.
That's right.
And determine whether that met your expectations of the restored wetland area.
And
I understand that Rebecca went out there.
She did.
And we have a lot of comments about how to dress up the granite bounds.
Yeah, actually it looked great. I did observe those granite posts, almost 25 feet. He did say that he had a little bit of difficulty in some areas because of tree roots. And I said, well, 25 feet here or there. You can see it very, very plainly. And the vegetation looked very dense. I thought it looked good. I did read, I think John Rockwood's.
Was Jock Rockwood's? Yeah.
Rockwood's report, and I noticed actually more species. I didn't notice all the species. I didn't get in there, but I did see a lot of wetland grasses that had established themselves in there. So I thought it looked good. He did leave a silt fence and some hay bales, and he didn't know if we wanted him to take that out.
It seems pretty stable now, right? They probably can remove it.
Yeah.
Upstream, up gradient.
And he did ask about what, you know those plaques that we have that mm-hmm. say well.
Mm-hmm.
I said, was I supposed to give them to him and put them on the post? I said, I don't know. I don't think so. But I said, you may want to call Chuck. Did he call you about that?
They've already picked them up.
Okay.
Great.
If Brian or Chuck, correct me if I'm wrong, but this was primarily seed rather than plugs, wasn't it?
Plus volunteer, stuff that was there.
Yeah, plus
yeah.
I think, so by the time this happened, me and Will went out there, ex-commission member, on the day that the day prior to it being, getting underway. And he was about to purchase a bunch of material for this job, but that volunteer growth had started to come up, just like the report said.
Mm-hmm.
And we told him to hold off on it. And this is the result of that. Now, it was reported to the commission that that's what, in fact what we did.
Right.
So I don't think they purchased too much at all.
So they didn't put any seed in?
They may have put some seed in there. But they didn't have to purchase anything else. I think when we were there, the sensitive fern was going, the cinnamon fern. That was pretty well established, and it was even going up the slope. So that's, I don't know if you noticed right at the peak, if you saw anything getting mowed down at that area, but it seemed to head right up there when we saw it. And since then, there's been lawn established, and all those areas look good. So, the report is, I don't know about seed. That's mostly volunteer vegetation. So even the trees and the shrubs will come back at
it
some
looks
point.
Good. I didn't go by there within the last week, but within the last month I've been by there, and
mm-hmm.
it looked good back then. So.
Yeah, I was by this week.
It's too dry for cattails, right? At least in that upper portion. But down by the vernal pool, I think I remember seeing some.
On Pearl Street. I think there's some there. I didn't see any cattail.
Well, I think this is turned out pretty well.
I think it looks good.
This picture does look like there's a little standing water. Is there?
I didn't observe any.
That fills right up in the spring with water. So it wasn't changed at all, because that's what the historic photo showed, that area would fill in with water. And this spring, it was all ice, melted down.
Looks like water.
So
the last page there.
Yeah. So I think they got it pretty darn close to what it was before, except the trees are missing, the mature trees.
They'll come.
Right, right. So we only have this under an enforcement order, so we can only just release that.
Do we...
So just direct me to do that, and I usually just write a letter saying that at take a vote, and direct me to write the letter.
So I'll entertain a motion to close out the enforcement order for 29 Gavin Circle and to issue a letter to that.
We'll send it out.
To that
post haste.
We are going to have them pick up the silt fencing and is everything established?
We probably could.
I think that's definitely, they definitely want to take that out of there as soon as possible.
They're
I can mention it in the letter, but, you know, that would, you just said that they didn't know when that was supposed to come out. So I will put that in the letter. Yeah, unless it's Mass Highway, we don't leave any. That was tongue in cheek, but.
Do we have these pictures electronically?
We have the report electronically.
What I'm thinking is that this is such a good example of what is now a created wetland that might be a good thing to keep on file. Because we have a few examples in town, this being one of them, that wetlands with the proper hydrology can do pretty well.
This is not exactly a created wetland.
So I move the issue of release of the enforcement order.
Second. All those in favor? All right.
All right.
So if anybody's here for the 306 Main Street notice of intent, continued notice of intent, that is going to be continued to which meeting, Chuck?
It's the 9th of July.
9th of July.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise known as Pizza World.
Listen to me this morning when I went by Starbucks, there was a big fry sitting on that site.
Could be. I mean, I don't know if they're getting
it might
some
be
stuff.
Just
the
equipment for that construction.
They've been staging
it. Right.
Okay. So I see the notice of intent for Oak Street is on the old new business.
Right. Pick that up.
Yeah, we had an electronic copy, but there wasn't a copy in our package. Is that right?
No.
Okay. Do you have a hard copy with you?
I do.
Because I didn't print out a hard copy, but I got a few questions.
I got your questions and I added the ones I understood into the order of conditions. That's doctored for you. So if you want to go through them, I mean, that's what I interpreted what you wanted.
Okay, that's number two, that's good. So we know that we're going to be below the ground, which we knew before, so I think that's good. Okay.
They're going to be deep there.
Finding number 8. So they are replacing the existing stormwater system. Correct.
Where it interferes with their pipe, they are.
He did say that, yeah.
Okay. But the town will own what they build, right?
Right. Eventually. I thought you... So you're asking for them to maintain it well during the construction project. So I wrote... until the certificate
good.
Of compliance on C, I added.
Good. That's good. That's exactly what I was thinking of. Okay, special condition 15. On... page 18.
I changed the owner to the MWRA.
Okay. Okay, now number
18. I agree. I didn't know if they're going to run into trees and replace any. Maybe it's. You know, it's.
It didn't hurt to leave it.
Yeah, it was. I don't have a preference. Sorry, this is so abstract.
Oh, that's
okay. There's a history here. They put in the first part of the pipe. The pipe is not completed yet. And the first part of the pipe is already in West Street, and then it makes a right-hand turn on Oak Street, and then it's dead end right there. And they're going to pick it up there and continue constructing. And we had some serious dewatering problems on the West Street section. So 18, it's fine if we leave it in, but I hope it's not necessary. I don't know of any trees that are going to cut down.
Well, they actually did cut some trees down in preparation for this already. I got a few phone calls.
On Oak Street?
Yeah, right across the street from 62, they cut a tree down. Not recently, maybe, I don't know, the last cutting cycle.
The town did, right?
Yeah. Well, the town's, some group in the town, yeah.
Okay, so number 9, I think you added my suggestion, but I'm not sure everybody's comfortable with this, including George. We added, or Chuck added a sentence at the end of number 19. It says, if in the judgment of the Conservation Commission, after consultation with the commissioners, if in the judgment of the Conservation Commission administration, after consultation with the commissioners, the dewatering system is not functioning adequately, the applicant will install, operate, and maintain a more aggressive system such as frac tanks. Do you think MWRA and it will...
We were almost at that point on West Street. I
know.
Yeah, so...
And I thought they said, and when we get to the minutes we can clarify, I thought they said when they were in here that they had provisions for a frac tank, but I might have been just hoping it said that.
I think it's fine to leave it in. It's going to be, to be at that same point we were at West Street, there were almost no other options at that point, and it was only the volume of what they were taking out of the pit that stopped them from doing it in the first place.
Right. Now, you would question, after consultation with the commissioners, I would suggest we leave that in there. It doesn't say approval. Mm. It just says consultation. So, you know, before you shut them down, you call the
What's your interpretation of commissioners? Usually I'm not calling everyone. I'm usually calling the chair, the vice chair. Would that be enough? I think if it got to that point, we would all know about it for sure. It wouldn't happen over the course of 3 days.
I think something that major, I'd feel better if you at least left a phone message for all the commissioners.
Okay. Or email?
Or email.
Okay.
I think email is sufficient.
Yeah, I hope, yeah.
And in fact,
I think that you
more
know,
likely to get an email
the discussion
email
with the chair
call.
And the vice chair, and then to just summarize it in an email would work.
Okay. I think so.
Okay, that's good. Now, the next one was special condition 26. Okay, now this is where maybe it's a little clearer now. Beginning with the construction of the draining system and continuing until a certificate of compliance is issued. Okay, MWRA shall maintain the roadway. Great, that's perfect.
And number 18 refers to the first page of the state form. So those are just general conditions, and that talks about keeping the street clean.
All right. I was looking at special conditions,
yeah.
I guess, 18.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. So that's good. So that means MWRA has to maintain that drainage system during the entire, not only construction period, but until I guess they're going to have to turn the drain system over to the town, and George will have to accept it, I hope. Right?
Wouldn't that be funny? Yeah, I guess he would. I don't know what they're going to say about that, never mind. So, if there would be a formal taking it over, but I think they should maintain it during the life of their project.
Absolutely. Okay. All right, I think that's all I had. Again, thanks, Chuck, for getting this to us early so we could look through it, because I think this, it's a good order, and I think to have a chance to look at it, we can put our minds together. And we said it last week, but I'll repeat it. Things were going pretty badly. Once we finally got MWRA's attention, things turned around right away. And they were ready to shut it down. They were ready to require fracking too. But once you get two or three steps away from the owner, things deteriorate pretty quickly.
Okay.
Okay, so I move we issue this order of conditions as amended tonight.
Second.
All those in favor? All right, then.
You have it right here if you'd like to sign it.
Yeah, we can do that.
Those are with your changes.
So, when are they going to start this fall? No, they haven't even put it at the bid yet.
No, it's
going
to be a while.
They had a design, though. I think they designed both at the same time. I'm not sure they have stormwater design.
It's not 7:40 yet, so I'm not going to move on to Main Street. We do the certificate of compliance for Lindsay Lane.
Yeah. Oof. Always curious about these old certificates of compliance. So they come in a lot, and you read a condition and it asks for a certified, you know, a letter from an engineer, as-built plans, Form 8A, all that, but it's 18 years old.
We did do a site visit, is that correct?
That's correct.
Excellent. Or you did a site visit.
I did. and I saw the silt fence on that plan. Let me see if it.
You saw it in the field?
Yeah.
And it's 18 years old?
24 years old. It's not 18.
Wait, it's what?
It's 24 years old.
24.
Still catching silt.
Well, no, there's not much. It's right at ground level. So I was able to see that. What I didn't understand from you, Chuck, continues to function and see if the 20-foot setback.
Those are right out of the order of conditions. So there's a basin there that it says in the order of conditions, and then there was a restriction saying that you wouldn't be able to turn from the wetland 20 feet zone of natural vegetation, not the 25 foot. So there was more than 20 feet of natural vegetation between the wetland and the lawn, then that was maintained. And just to find out if the detention basin looked like it was maintained.
25 foot zone of natural vegetation?
Well, in this particular order, it's 20 feet.
No, I'm not so sure.
Do we have a bylaw? We did have a bylaw.
Was this a Jack Rivers?
Was it? Fairwoods Acres subdivision.
There was definitely standing water in back there.
Are we going to ask them to remove that silt fence?
I don't know if it's possible. It sounds like it's.
You don't think
we'd do more damage?
Yeah.
There'd be more damage done by removing it. Part of the environment now.
Yeah. 25 more years. Cut it at ground level.
Yeah, I'd be happy with that.
It is at ground. It is at ground.
Oh, it is?
Yes. I mean, it, yeah, you can see it, but it's not up at all.
I'm inclined to leave it.
I think maybe for future sites, we should pay a little more attention and make sure they get that thing out of there instead of everything stabilized.
Were you the first owner of that property?
Yes.
Okay.
I believe Jack Rivers originally tried to develop it.
Yeah. Okay.
But I, for some reason, he became disconnected, and I thought it was Fairchild that actually developed it.
Okay.
So, there are no outstanding issues. Do we, someone want to make a motion to?
This is just a partial certificate of compliance because it's under the subdivision. There's a whole
right.
list of.
So the lot would be, houses. The lot would be cleared,
yeah.
and there's a number of other ones that aren't. So. I'll entertain a motion for a partial certificate of compliance for 39 Lindsay Lane.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay.
So how many other houses are they down there that are part of that permit?
I'm sorry?
How many other houses in that development?
I got a letter about 5 years ago from Fran Fink at the time. I think there was maybe a dozen of us on the list.
Wow.
So there was a few addresses on Lindsay, a couple on Fairchild Drive, and one or two on Jessica.
And you're the only one that stepped up?
I don't know.
I can't remember any.
We might have had one or two that have come through since then, I think. Okay.
So there's 14 in all, but it doesn't look like many of them have stepped up.
I'm the first one.
Yeah. I don't know if you're the first one, but there's not more than three, you being one of those three, so.
All right, it being 7:40 or after, we'll continue the discussion on map 51, lot 95, Ahern, which is Main Street. There's no number assigned. The public hearing has been closed. The comments are closed, but we're going to discuss the order of conditions. Is that correct, Chuck?
Did we get the order?
No, you didn't. That I didn't finish off the order of conditions. I have.
Ah.
So this is still hanging out there. So do you want to look at it now? I can print out copies.
Well, I think we can wait. Probably should wait till you're.
I'd rather wait if we have it done.
Yeah, I think that's my thought was that the way you closed this and then continued it meant you want it written, you're going to ask to have it written at this meeting, and you're going to sign it at the next meeting. And just remember, I won't be here at the next meeting, so we'll review it.
Will somebody have the electronic version so if there are any changes we can make?
Yeah.
I mean, you'll
don't have to issue it. I'll be back in time to issue it. You don't have to send it out or just sign it.
Okay.
That's all you'll have to do.
All right.
But on when I was writing it, I did notice a few things. Let me find this. I thought I had a note that said this, that Jack was going to look into a gravel strip at the edge of the driveway. That's not on the new plan.
Oh, he did submit a new plan?
Yes, and that was in the packet.
It was.
I did see that.
Oh, no, I didn't. It was. Or is this yours? That's the only
one. 17. The stamp on it's the 17th. The receipt stamp.
It's just a long map. It's not attached anything.
Was that not the filter trench?
Yeah.
That's coming off the.
Did I miss it?
Trench grade, he has it right there.
Yeah, he does have it.
He's got the grate right at the driveway, and then it's going to flow right to the filter areas.
Yep, it's on
there.
Yeah. June, yeah, the stamp is June 17th. The received stamp, Town of Reading Building Department.
That's funny, I see it on
Great. Great.
This is the same one.
Invert 105, so
it's not the same one?
Right.
Should be.
It
so
is, well,
this is going to prevent from
right
going to the road.
Here. Prevent, no.
The drainage will
not
run on the main
there
street.
Correct.
Yes. Okay.
It flows from the house to the road.
Okay.
And he was going to check with MassDOT with respect to the drainage.
Are we sure it flows?
Yeah, if you look at the grade at the garage, it's 107 right at the entrance of the garage, and then the grade at the gutter is 106.3.
But it's going to hit that gutter, then where is it going to go? Infiltrate? Is that the
goal? Yeah, so I think the idea is for it to flow through this trench, the gravel
crushed
trench.
Stone. Yep.
Crushed stone filled the trench.
Yep.
And then infiltrate in the yard.
Yeah, so it goes 6-inch HDPE into the gravel trench and into the ground.
So it, well, the hope is it will flow south to north through this trench and then infiltrate in the yard there just north of the driveway?
Correct.
Is that the way you read this?
Correct.
Correct.
Keeps the runoff on the site.
How does it work with that retaining wall? Wait, am I saying that right?
It's going around the
back side of it.
Yeah, right.
The front side of it.
The right. Front side, right.
The street
the
side.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That should work pretty well. Because then it would eventually get to the wetlands, but it would have close to 100 feet to go before it actually got there.
Right.
And all that's vegetated, so if that works, those trenches can be tricky, but if that works, it'll be a good solution.
So the retaining wall is in front of it between the driveway. So it's trench, filter, retaining wall, and then the driveway.
Correct.
That thing in back is the erosion control. So it's going to make its way through the retaining wall.
You're talking about the lower one?
Yeah.
Well, should go by the corner of it anyway, the way it's graded. See how the proposed grading comes down and connects from the lower wall to the upper wall? It's gonna shed away from that.
Well, it wasn't there before, so at least it's there.
All right, so we're
that's
all set to.
Yeah, I can send. That was really, that's the only thing I found.
I mean, I'm glad to see that 2 foot wide, 2 foot deep crushed stone filter trench. I'm not sure it's necessary, but certainly can't hurt.
What was added in when a comment from the abutters were, they were asking about the runoff into the road. So that was our solution.
Yeah, I mean, it might be open. Because once he gets off the driveway, there's no way he's getting on the road because it's a pretty good drop there.
Any conditions that you guys aren't standard that you want to think about, I can add in prior to the meeting?
Well, we discussed a number of items at the hearing, is that correct? You incorporated those?
Yep.
There was just the flagging in the field, and there was a couple
did that on the plan.
Yeah.
add some red maples, save 30 trees, dry well. So we didn't resolve MassDOT. I'm not sure that's our issue.
Yeah, I wouldn't worry about that.
And then we asked for orange construction fence between 1257.
On the lot line.
Plan? I don't see it. He said he'd do it, but I don't see it on the plan. We can just put it in the order of conditions.
Make it a condition.
That's so easy, they would do that just on the pre-activity meeting. So I'll put it in as a condition. No, that's all I have.
Okay.
So it's just the orange construction fence.
All right.
And as you notice, this is outside the 35-foot. No need for a variance.
Yep.
This is pretty much, I don't want to say this is what we want, but it doesn't need a variance.
Right. Good point. That's all the major items on the agenda. And I see that we have quite a few people left. So I think I know what you're here for. You're here for General Way, is that correct? The discussion. You're here for General Way as well. And you're here for?
I was here on the Zero Main Street.
Zero Main
yeah.
Street. Okay. And you were here on Zero Main Street as well?
I'm here for Makabaskit.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
General
Way.
Okay.
General Way.
And you're here for, sir?
I'm just observing.
Excellent. And you, sir?
I'm just here to for Main Street, but might understand if everything goes well right now, if we finish up now, that I come back next time and you guys are going to sign the order conditions, I can take it and record it and get going because I have constraints on the P&S.
Correct.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, thanks.
All right.
Thank you.
So then Market Basket it is. Or, excuse me, Dennis Properties. It's not Market Basket.
Good evening. For the record, John Dick, Hancock Associates. I'm here representing Dennis Redding Properties, and this is Jamie Shaw and Jody Hayward, both also representing Dennis. They've been told to stay back there and be quiet. I'm going to make an argument for a waiver of a considerable portion of the filing fee, and the reason I'm back before you is that we got a positive determination last time. That's kind of over here. We knew we were going to be in there messing with wetlands. Of course, the act was applicable. And we know that we now have a 20-page ecological restoration notice of intent, which, among other things, involves advertising the this is getting into some serious stuff. It's environmental policy. It approaches a MEPA review on some levels.
Did you say MEPA review?
Yes.
What threshold is it?
We're not triggering a threshold, but ordinarily when you file with the environmental monitor, when you advertise the environmental monitor, that's the intent, is to alert other regulatory agencies. Oh, hey, something's going on here, and it's bigger than mom and pop building a driveway to their house, a subdivision access road, that sort of thing. And this is bigger. This is considerably bigger. When they wrote fee provisions in your bylaw, the notion was, because at the time that was what the regulations clearly said, no net loss. So any square foot of wetland that was altered in any way cost the applicant an $11 filing fee. Any linear foot of bank also cost $11. That's a wonderful design when you're talking about clipping an edge of a wetland with a driveway, building a sewer pipe that runs linear for a finger-like projection. But what we're proposing here is a wholesale alteration of nearly an acre of wetland. And calculated filing fee just for those two aspects was $450-something thousand. That's just the filing fee. The budget for the project, when I came before you 2 weeks ago, was a tenth of that. That is to say, we were going to pay 10 times the filing fee that we were planning to spend on actually doing the work out there, which is largely landscaping. I think you kind of liked the landscaping proposal, but the landscaping proposal's not before you. It really only was before you could get the determination of applicability. Now, what I've done in the past 2 weeks is I've given my clients a memo parsing your regulations. And I'm going to go at this fast because I figure you know your regulations and you'd like to go home sometime tonight. There's a $1,000 basic filing fee. That includes just the filing fee plus all applicable fees, paragraphs F through K. So then I go through F through K. F is a boundary delineation fee. That's $1.25 a linear foot. We aren't disputing any aspect of the boundary delineation. The boundary delineation is the same line that appeared on the plans that you've reviewed since the 80s. It's always been where it is. In point of fact, we don't care where it is. We're calculating our area of alteration based on
those
the
flags
area of alteration.
Are
those are
large.
Those are flags of history.
Would you be willing to put them back?
I could. Yeah, I could put them back basically by survey where they originally were. And that's probably the smart thing to do, just so we know where we are on the ground. I'm arguing because we're not asking for boundary delineation. We don't want to pay a fee for the review of boundary delineation. It is what it is. It's already on plans of record. We're not asking to change it. We're asking to go in there and mess with it. And you understand, I think, the nature of the messing with it. It's all to the good, I think. Alteration within the buffer zone, $1.25 a square foot. Now, that's for any temporary or permanent alteration within 25 square feet of a resource area. That's where we came up with, we've got this area that we're going to modify, we're going to do amendments to the vegetation. Some of it's not wetland, some of it's buffer zone, but it's all within 25 feet. So we use that basic area to calculate the fee, and we went with a higher number, $11 a square foot. We could parse it out, we could say, you know, some of it's only $1.25 a square foot, but either way you figure it, it's an awful lot of money. It's a huge sum of money. Yes?
Could I interrupt? I think Mr. Walsh is probably here for me.
Did I miss it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did they vote?
We got a new set of plans.
Another set of plans? Oh, was that?
No, it was from last.
It was reflecting the discussion we had 2 weeks ago.
Just an added a trench on it and a few trees.
Did they mark the line? The remark?
Yep.
Yes.
Yes.
Moved the flags?
They did.
I don't know if they moved the flag.
That was an order of condition.
No, didn't go out.
They drew a new delineation line showing 6 and 7 moved up,
yep.
6 moved up 5 feet, 7 moved up 7 feet.
Right. They marked the line, Chuck. They were supposed to move that. They were supposed to remark
physically
those.
In the field?
Yes, they were.
Yeah.
That was one of the orders.
He said
conditions.
He would.
Yes.
He might have. I don't know if he did or
yeah.
not.
Yeah. I had 8th grade graduation, so I'm sorry I'm late. I'm sorry to interrupt here, folks. But there were two conditions. That was one, and the second one was the driveway.
Well, the driveway said, well, we can make sure prior to construction that those flags are in the right place.
Yep.
Well, included in the conditions.
Yeah.
No one went out there.
No.
I did not.
That's
no.
These right, Chuck.
I'll take some.
I had a blessed by a Buddhist monk, so
so it's good. But I'm all set now.
Hasten to Chuck you.
No,
I don't. No. Says revised wetland line 519-15. So it was originally done 3/31/2015. So it looks like it's revised. We need to just go out and verify that it's been done in the field.
That's easy enough to add into the conditions. To verify
it's been added already, so yeah. Again, that's what upheld the vote last time, so those two items. So, there's an abutter here, right? I'm just making sure. I mean, I understand. I know you're looking at me like I'm crazy, but
I'm not, it's fine. We can move them in the field, that's not a problem.
Yeah.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Anything else?
So did the vote occur? Did it?
We don't have an order of conditions prepared, but it's likely that it will be prepared and finalized at the next meeting, more than likely, and signed.
2 weeks.
Okay. 2 weeks?
Yep, July 9th.
And again, the order of conditions are just those two items, just the mark. Physical movement of the flag.
Our order conditions has boilerplate items in it, and then special conditions that the commission wants, and those are developed during the meeting. So, I mean, that flag, moving that flag, that's great. That's for you guys, for the homeowners that are around there. They just want to see that happen. But for the commission, we're going to be going off the plan from here forward.
All right. Back to you, sir.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Yep.
Sorry to interrupt.
Okay, back to the beginning. The $1,000 base fee does not seem negotiable. We're not reviewing the wetland boundary, but we'll reset where the wetland boundary was determined to be at some point in the distant past. I'm not going to delineate. I'm not going to dicker about where I think the line ought to be. I'll put it back where it shows on the plan record. The clearing of invasives proposed in the buffer zone along the easterly property line, that's the property line that runs out between the two markets out to the street, and it's monumented as buffer zone. It is being left uncut, and there's a power easement, I think a sewer easement running down that. We want to clear that out and keep the poplars under control, because it's just a refuge for them to come back in of the site. That would be 750 square feet. The fee for this category of activity at $1.25 per square foot is $937.50.
If I can interrupt again, those fees are for alteration, and I'm not sure removing invasives is alteration.
I like the sound of that. I'm not sure either.
Jamie, remember the main focus of this project is to make sure that everyone can see the strip mall behind it. It's really not to clear. So when you're talking about fees and what they're doing, there's a different purpose going on.
And activity. We're jumping around in there with any kind of equipment. If we're disturbing any soil at all, if we're planting, seeding, removing plants, it's activity. So I think possibly one could argue that this doesn't even apply because we're not really altering. Let's say it does. It's $937.50. That's $1,937.50. Floodplain mapping. This whole thing is mapped in a sort of a regular floodplain area that isn't characterized as to elevation, and there's a provision in that aspect of the regulations that says activity in the floodplain and outside of any other resource area or within the buffer zone. Since we are in a resource area or buffer zone, that paragraph H, doesn't seem to apply. No feeding. Next one, vernal pool habitat. There isn't any map on a site. There's none observed to be on a site. I didn't see any signs of vernal pool activity on the site, so that doesn't seem applicable. You got past paragraph I, get close to the end. Work in bank per paragraph K, $11 a linear foot, 260 linear feet, additional filing fee, 2,860.
That, so that, you measure the entire bank within the property to come up with that?
No, that's only the section of bank that we're proposing to alter, which is two segments east of the access road and a couple of small gaps along the side cast berm. There's a lot more than 260 feet of bank on this site.
But you're altering 200 and some odd number of feet of bank?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And
by altering,
most of that's not digging. Most of that's just removing poplars.
Removing what?
Poplars. We got big poplars growing in the bank and
but
in the berm.
I would be interested in how many linear feet of bank you're altering by changing the grade.
About 50.
50. And what's the number of dollars per linear foot?
50 times $1.25 is $75. Much more reasonable fee, I think.
Yeah, but when you're altering, not altering, but removing poplars, you're removing roots, so you're affecting soil structure,
right.
And bank, you know, soil structure has some.
If you don't remove the roots, you're not removing poplars. You're just encouraging them
right.
to grow.
But what my point is that, you know, you have
right.
a structure to the bank, and that has some significance. It's not just the elevation, to my mind.
Okay, paragraph K is the last one. Paragraph K is the big one. That's an $11 per square foot. I'm sorry. No, that's right. Ecological restoration area in bordering vegetated wetland. Total fee for that activity at $11 per square foot. It's 42,425 square feet. The fee, just for this aspect of your bylaw, $466,675. So my total estimated filing fee.
I'm sorry to keep it. I'll
yep.
forget if I don't take a piece at a time.
Yep.
So that how many square feet did you say? 40?
Just short of an acre.
42,425. Is that all the boring vegetation wetlands on the parcel?
No. Not by a stretch.
Okay. So how did you identify those 42,000 square feet? What's happening?
We struck a line
on
the plan.
Pardon me?
We struck a line on the plan.
And so what's happening in those 42?
That's the control of invasives, limbing up of trees, and basically restoration of a wet meadow condition that floods.
John, is that mostly this area?
Exactly.
Does it include, this is the buffer zone, correct?
Most of that is buffer zone.
Okay.
And bank. Yep.
It just explained to me, I took a look out there today.
Nice color. Yeah.
Thanks. What part of the bank are you talking about?
Here, there's
the
bank and a bank, both 130 feet long.
Mm-hmm.
One of those banks is also a berm for the detention basin.
Right.
But it's a bank, nevertheless.
Yeah.
So there's your 260 linear feet there. I added in 30, 40 feet in here because I'm going to make a couple of gaps in this bank over here.
What are you doing on this bank? What
just going to open it up so the water can come up out of the brook, get into the wetland, get back out of the wetland into the brook. Right now, there's literally a dam along the edge of the brook, two and a half feet high. Prevents the book overflowing until it gets really, really high. So essentially, you've got a wetland alongside a brook. There's no connection between them.
Except to the groundwater.
The wetland's not a bordering vegetated wetland. It's an isolated vegetated wetland right next to a brook. So it causes massive holes in that berm.
So this is the berm, this side that you're talking
yeah.
about?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, let's think like a muskrat. So,
It's really a levee, I'd say, more than
yeah, it's a levee. That's exactly what it is. It wasn't intended to prevent overflow, but that's what it is. So this is the BBW here, in large part. Over here, there's not really any BBW to speak of. There's just two banks, and there's buffer zone activity.
So your activity in those 42,000 square feet
mm-hmm.
is... Number one, remove invasives.
Remove invasives, Limb up some of the trees.
Limb up some of the native trees.
And seed.
And seed.
We're not going to plant much of anything.
And
we're just going to seed.
Allow surface water.
And we're going to open up a couple of gaps. Now, we can't remove that entire berm because there's 12-inch trees growing in it. But there are places we can reach it.
You're not going to change the elevation in that 42,000 square feet?
Only in that levee.
Only in the levee. And you're not going to remove any native trees?
May not.
Yeah.
So, here's my recommendation. We come up with a total estimated filing fee, $471,472.50. Let's round it up, say $500,000. That's 10 times the budget I estimated to do the work out here. The work's going to be more expensive than I thought it was. Probably going to double the budget. That's still 5 times the activity itself.
So, Johnny, I think it's $100,000?
I'm thinking 1%.
No,
4,700.
The cost of the project.
I'm thinking 50 to 100,000 tops to do this. 100,000 if we had to plant.
I see what you're saying.
But really, I mean, with seed, this could come in under 50. So I'm asking the Conservation Commission to consider a fee equivalent to 1% of the calculated amount. That's 4,714.72. How much? 4,714. That amounts to a little less than 10% of the budget for the job. Still a lot.
My problem with that is 1% is arbitrary. Why did 0.5? Why did 1.5? I would be more comfortable in applying the stated fee for linear feet of bank, where we're at 50 feet or whatever, where we're actually changing the elevation of the berm or the levee. And then have, through their deliberative process, have the commissioners assign a different value per square feet in the boring vegetated wetlands, something lower than the $11 we have stated, and base that negotiated, or that alternative fee per square feet based on the type of alteration. Rather than putting in a sewer pipe or driveway, removing invasive, allowing water to flow in, and doing some limiting. I would be more happy with that. It's less capricious than saying, or arbitrary than saying 1%. So that's off the top of my head, my thought.
Any other comments from the commission members? Any thoughts?
I still disagree with you, Jamie, on linear feet of bank. But that isn't the big money issue on this project.
Right.
The money issue is obviously
BBD.
Yep.
Or
vegetative mountain.
BBD is poison laid doors. I don't think that's involved.
Yeah, we pay the full fee. This is just not going to happen. We're not going to file.
That's understandable.
And again, I want to emphasize, at 4,700, 1% of the calculated total, we are still at close to 10% of our budget.
Chair, what are your thoughts?
I actually liked that idea. When we left the last meeting, I thought it was decided that they would pay something around $2,000, and the commission, after reviewing the ecological restoration notice of intent, would systematically come up with different figures if they thought more fees needed to be added to that to justify the review that they were doing. That's where he left it. So there was no discussion between the two meetings about how to how to pay or how to figure out what the fee should be. And I do like trying to, you know, understand what we would charge for an ecological restoration project. And almost to the point where I'd want to find out why we decided, or what percentage is 11% of, or $11 per square foot compared to, you know, just the, you know, the $120 that we usually charge for a regular, you know, starting point of a notice of intent. I mean, it seems to me that if we thought about it, we could figure out something that works. I also would like to make sure that this project is sustainable and has a bond or something we can tap into looking out over 10 years. I've got calls from neighbors that are not very happy in that area, because this is not the first time this group has come in and asked for things. The light, the shading, all these things should have been looked into in the past. The town hasn't actually found the files yet, but it seems like a lot of things were allowed because of this shaded area. This growth, the undergrowth, and the trees. So it's important to that neighborhood to maintain something over there. And I know that that's going to come up also. So doesn't it? So what do I think about the money? Commercial guy in, just without basing it on anything wetland, I would say that this is a commercial piece of property. I expect them to pay more than everybody else to do work, and that's how our regulations look. We treat developers differently in our regulations as far as variance goes, as far as fees go, and so when we're giving people breaks, they should get less of a break than a homeowner should get. So, or provide a benefit that's something for the community. And I'm not sure changing this wetland is what I'm talking about. So, that's all.
I think I've voiced my personal opinion on the fee structure as it is, at least for work within the wetland, that fee was developed not for a project. That fee was developed for a project that's going to, as you stated, put a driveway through a wetland. Or, you know,
stay out of the way.
And that's the reason why it's set the way it is. We never intended, the commission that before me anyway, that developed that fee, never intended it to be a more restoration type project. Now, does that mean the fee should be zero? Not necessarily. I think that, you know, Jamie's on to something with, you know, let's determine a fee for work in this area. The question is, how do they proceed? If we come back, if they apply with a notice of intent, pay $2,000, and then they come before us, they present us with the plans, and we say, no, $50,000 is our fee. We've led them down the path, and then shut the door on. So, what kind of you know, we can't give them an assurance, but you know, I think they really probably need a good indication as to which direction we're heading. I mean, it's not, at least that's my opinion. I think, you know, I would be hesitant as an applicant to apply with this unknown, you know, well, you know, we think it's $150,000. So, and I know that's over your, I think it's tough to be in their situation. Regardless if they're commercial or a homeowner, you know.
No one would buy a car on those terms. No one would take a lease on those terms.
I don't know what the solution is. I just know that that's a tough situation, you know, for the applicant.
personally, and I don't speak for the commission, but personally, if they came in with a notice of intent and filed a fee and applied a figure of something around a buck per square foot of bordering vegetated wetland, and the alteration of the bank, maybe listening to Becky, the full value where they're opening the bank and maybe half the value where they're removing poplars per square foot, and came up with that fee, I would think that would make sense. I do think the benefit to the community has to be part of this. And I think we talked about a trail last time. There seems to be some appetite for that. And I'm thinking back on Austin Prep, where we asked for, and we ought to follow up on this because they're nearing construction or nearing the end of construction, but we asked for that illustrated board for a wetland. So we're going to have a nice wetland in there if we believe the applicant. And we could have a nice educational board saying, you know, this is a wetland, here's the blustering wetland, here's the cattails, here's the red maple, and these are the ecological attributes of each. So there would be a little educational opportunity along this trail. And that could be a big benefit, but that is, could be a fair amount of pedestrian traffic through there. Because people will be coming from Main Street over Walker Brook down that trail. So that's my
like a self-guided trail.
$470,000 thought on this.
Let me jump in here and interject that a dollar a square foot is still close to $50,000.
It's $42,000.
Yeah, times 11.
So you're saying that project is uneconomical at the cost of $150,000?
For a fee?
No.
No, for total.
Total.
Yeah, I mean, my client's not going to do the project if the work costs that. Never mind the bottom.
And speaking for the property, I mean, as we all know, the center is vacant. We have some high vacancies over there. We're trying to drum up activity, trying to bring tenants to the site. We're still paying our taxes. The taxes don't go down when the tenants move out and don't pay their rent. We're stuck in a situation. That's why we came to the town for help. We started with every member that would listen to us. We need help. We're also looking to improve what's there now. And I think you all agreed at the last hearing, this is an improvement.
Yeah, I would second that. When they first came through the development 10 years ago, when Market Basket ended up there, before they did that improvement, that place was a mess. I mean, there was trash, there was contaminated soil. It certainly bringing development in there has improved the overall condition. I can speak to that from firsthand knowledge.
And just one other thing, sorry. We work with the community. We do whatever we can. I take every phone call personally. I'll give out my cell number to anyone that wants it. We've worked with anyone that had an issue. We have shields on the lamps that are in the driveway now. We'd be happy to review that with anyone, take your advice. It just has to make sense to do, you know, the work. As far as that trail goes, as I mentioned, it was mentioned the town had a consultant to see what the long-term plan was for the town in Reading, South Main Street, different areas. One recommendation was for one general way to be housing, and that's how the trail came. So I said, in 15, 20 years, you know, maybe, and that's when I spoke to the person. Who knows what's going to happen? It's not going to be turned to housing. It's a market basket. It's a retail center. That was a long-term vision by a consultant. So I don't think it's fair to say, hey, put in a walking trail now. We don't even know, you know, how that would work. And to tie it to something this quick, I don't think it's fair.
Was the skateboard park part of that also, that vision?
No. I was going to bring... I didn't
that was
see
10
it.
Years ago.
No, that was 10 years ago before Market Basket. But this most recent one, this is just the first one. The next meeting is September 12th, if any of you are around, for the next phase of this. This is the third of four series. So it just says where, you know, what they think should go, where mixed use would work, where residential would work. It's very, I mean, we participate with all of them. I participate on the board to be more business friendly, because we'd like to see that as well. We get a lot of people say, we walk into town hall and they wave all the red flags and, oh, you got issues everywhere, which we really don't. You know, we've been successful, I think, at improving the site.
So it's really not supposed to be a negotiation. we need a number, we need a community benefit, and we need to be reassured that this thing will be sustainable for 10 years.
By number, you mean a number of the
well,
fee, a dollar value.
If I could break it down, we have $50,000. That seems reasonable. I take a deep breath and you know, big deep happy breath with that. But that could be broken up into several ways. $4,000 of actual fee and $45,000 in, I don't know, between a bond and some project.
So you're saying rather than a fee, some other benefits?
I'm looking for a community benefit. It doesn't have to be on site, but you know, we're reducing the fees from $471,000. You know, basically, in street language, we're on the ground, you're still kicking us, you know? So, we're really down, you know, $4,500.
You
like that?
Yeah, I like that. What's the highest fee you can remember charging an applicant for a notice of intent?
$18,000. It was actually the government. I took personal pride in that myself.
18.
It was $18,000.
What did Redding Woods pay?
Oh, they had very little resource. Redding Woods?
Yeah.
That's Pulte?
Pulte, yeah.
But hold on a second.
They had almost no resource area. They were so small. The biggest fee we ever paid was Home Depot, Jordan's Furniture.
That's
right. That was like $80,000 or something.
But that was new development.
Well,
it was a dump.
Well,
it
was
a landfill.
The development of a landfill.
I hate saying like a broken record, but if a homeowner wanted to go in and remove invasives and restore the natural hydrology to the wetland on their property, I don't think we charge them for alteration of that wetland.
I tend to agree.
Right, but this has a twist to it, and you have to factor in that twist, and that's what I'm asking you guys to keep in mind.
The twist is?
Well, if we look through ecological restoration, the gate is, what is the primary purpose for this project? And the primary purpose for this project is actually not to restore the wetlands. It's to open up the site for visibility. So they don't make it through the gate, but that's up for you. You know, they may not make it through the gate, but that's up to you guys to decide. Question number one. John admitted that at the last, he freely says that that's what they're doing. So it can't just be thought of as a restoration project. I also want to bring into the community also, the people that live around that area.
Yeah.
If they're going to look at this thing 24/7 and, you know, in Supermax Theater in the wintertime when all the leaves are gone, it's going to be right in their backyard. That's why I say some sort of community benefit has to be factored in.
Chuck, did you say that you asked for some of the old filing? CPDC on this project regarding.
We've been looking through that.
To see what the issues were with lighting and screening.
It hasn't been sorted out yet. So it seems like it was mentioned. And
I know it hasn't got anything to do with wetlands, but if there are conditions to that permit, and I don't know if you folks said. Yeah, records.
We have records for the whole project.
Okay.
Hmm.
Becky,
I'm not sure
you said you did go back in that area.
No, I didn't go all the way to the wetlands because I had a short
time. You didn't meet the guy in the tent back there?
No, is there a guy back there?
Somebody living out there.
Oh, Christ.
There was, my backyard.
Glad I didn't go back.
Really?
It's fact,
there is
relocation now.
The young couple.
Yeah.
There are a lot of invasive species in there.
Oh boy.
Well, you know, and I'm gonna play devil's advocate with Chuck's statement about the primary purpose. If the end result is the same, from a wetland standpoint, from an ecological standpoint, the end result is the same.
Let's just say the same. Yeah.
Right. If it's the same. Regardless of the project, now they may not be able to file under ecological restoration if they don't pass that first test. However, that being said, regardless if the project primary purpose is to restore this wetland and remove invasives, if the end benefit's the same, then you know we really have to weigh it that way as well, or look at it that way, you know?
We have to file under the right permit.
Right.
This does not happen.
But I guess what I'm saying, with respect to this the fee structure and the benefit, there is a benefit here to just removing the invasives, and there is a community benefit there. Restoring flood storage, that's a huge community benefit in Reading.
Come on, we got a whole neighborhood here. I mean, that's not going to fly. That conservation stuff is not going to work in this case.
Well, I'm sorry, I don't understand what you mean.
I think that there's an opportunity to do the walking, the trail, or something that someone wants, some connectivity or something like that. But to
I'm
say the flood storage
out.
Is what we're going to tie the community benefit to.
No. I'm not ruling out
I don't
additional
agree.
Benefits. I'm just saying that those
And again, that would be something we would create and, you know, work. You know, kind of work that magic with a homeowner.
Right.
But this is a commercial property, and there's the potential to bring in big clients if this works out for them, and that way they wouldn't be doing it otherwise, right? It's everything in business is to make money. That's why you're doing it. So the hope is, and the calculation is, that with this work, you're gonna get some benefit.
Well, I think it's twofold, as you said. One is the improvement to the ecological restoration, which you all seem to agree that it would be better. You seem pleased with the plan. The other is visibility, trimming, like limbing the trees that we talked about. So you can see, people still say, I don't know market baskets in town. I still hear that from residents.
That's impossible.
They're not interested in saving money, apparently.
I have. You don't know how far we drive to go to market.
They are not interested in saving money.
No,
in
my house. It's not happening.
Think about this.
I know where they are in a 20-mile radius.
Think about this scenario. Let's say there was a parcel and it was 10 acres, and the middle of it was 2 acres of wetlands that were in awful shape. Invasive trash in there. Couldn't accomplish flood storage because the hydrology was all screwed up, and a developer wanted to come in and develop 8 of those 10 acres, and as part of it, to make that development for residential property more attractive, he was going to clean up that wetland, kind of like what they did on Scotland Yard, take out the fallen trees, take out all that stuff. I think we'd probably approve that.
How many acres in the
10-acre parcel?
And 2 acres are open space.
An acre or so was wetlands, and they were going to develop 8 acres, leave an acre of buffer zone, and take that wetland and clean it up, not alter it as far as fill or hydrology. I think we'd probably approve that and probably support it.
The question is an approval, though, it's filing fee and what that cost is.
Man, the cost to restore that. We had a similar project where they had exactly what you just said, and they wanted to give that open space to the town, but they refused to clean up all the invasive. They only wanted to go 10 feet in. So, you know.
But we encouraged them to go all the way in.
Mm.
Actually, I'm thinking of that one by REI, that over 55 community on Lowell Street.
Mm-hmm.
Part of the deal to get that, they infill the wetlands, but part of the deal to get that was they put a trail in there.
Right.
Which we're still going to change.
Right.
They put
right.
a trail in there, and there was junk in those wetlands. There was construction debris. There was all kinds of stuff in there. And they cleaned that up and improved the hydrology so you didn't have a big mat. We made them do it.
And the developer did put the money in an actual account
right.
that's controlled by the Conservation Commission
right.
and earmarked for that project. The problem with that project is the development doesn't want it anymore. And
right.
it never really got off
the
ground.
That was the problem. But we certainly didn't charge them a fee for alteration where they took all that junk out of the west.
That's always a benefit. No one else is going to do that. Your only opportunity is when work is going on.
Right, exactly. So,
So we don't have a number, but I still think my three points of what we're looking for. We're looking for a number, we're looking for a bond, sustainability, and a public benefit. Now, how that
I
agree with that 100%.
I tend to agree with that. Can we get to a place as a commission that will make the applicant feel comfortable that they're not going down this path, that they're going to have the door slammed on them? I mean, I don't know if that requires an actual number or some sort of, I don't know what it requires. Any suggestions? I mean,
we can all issue our personal opinions, but I'm not sure what the consensus would be. Because we're liable to have a different commission when this comes.
Certainly have a different commission in 10 years when the monitoring's over. Right. Different rights.
Yeah.
Going with what Chuck said, personally, only my opinion, if they came in here with a notice of intent, they described what they were going to do, and it reflected what we've been told, no cutting of native plants other than limbing, removal of invasives, restoring the hydrology and proving that hydrology is going to be restored, not just saying it, and a trail with some educational benefits and a fee in the $5,000 to $10,000 range, I could move forward on that.
A fee of $5,000 and a what was that thing for Maplewood? What was that called when they pocketed the money for that future project that we controlled? And a portion of that fee, something that we can control to use, to maintain it, to work on it, because if it
Johnson Wood had one of those too, because they had a trail that went through their property. What?
Well, it's not a bond. It's we want you to pay the commission.
The bond you get back.
We want to control. I'm saying, not we, to control a certain amount of money ourselves to take care of the property in addition to what we're going to require you guys to do.
I don't recall what they.
That,
what
well,
the
whatever.
Title
yeah,
was.
Or Maplewood. Yeah. It was like $10,000 to do that. We only have $7,000 left. And I was just talking to someone on the trail committee today, and we both think that there's not even enough money to build a trail there at this point.
I thought they were dead.
More like $20,000 worth of trail work, because it's all boardwalk.
But that was a several million dollar construction project.
Mm. Right.
I mean, they generated a huge amount of income.
Yeah. There's no other consideration. There's nothing new going in here. Maybe new tenants in an existing building.
But I mean, I could go with it as a concept.
It sounds reasonable to me as well. What you suggested, it sounds reasonable.
But I, again, if personal opinion, but if you come in here and start talking about cutting down red maples, it's a whole different story. That's not something that I want to see.
Well, I won't propose cutting red maples until the science backs me up. The science is 10 years behind the green. I'd like to pull down every like red maple I saw, but that's not the way the rules work.
Oh, a trail?
You know, when I looked at this area today, there's kind of an open area.
That would be a good idea. I'm not sure they want to go to that.
Yes, there is. Yeah, there's a little skunk cabbage meadow basically
in
there. And
yeah,
that's
right
basically
up in here.
What we're going for. That's disappearing under the maples. But the ground in there is incompetent. I don't think trees are ever going to get established in there.
I guess from my perspective, when I'm thinking about it, I don't know how much limbing you really want to do to open this up so that, you know, people can see back in this.
That's not a huge amount necessary. There's a lot of invasive shrubs in there, and really, they're the sight line. There are some coppiced maples out there. There are maples that were obviously cut or killed by ice over the years, and now you get 5-6 trunks as big around as my leg. But for the most part, what we're talking about doing is taking out buckthorn and honeysuckle and bittersweet in huge amounts, and that alone will open up the canopy by 30 or 40%.
And the mature catalpas.
And the mature catalpas.
Which there, I saw a lot right around.
There's a lot of catalpas out there.
Okay.
Everywhere else you go, there's black locusts. On that site, there's catalpas. I don't understand.
And in theory, and we need to be convinced of this, now that we have two engineers on the commission, we would double, triple check you. The hydrology has to be such that that buckthorn doesn't come back, that Phragmites that's already gotten hold doesn't come back.
No, that's a management
problem. If we go in there and clear the canopy, and we go back in 8 months and the thing's covered with Phragmites, we're not going to be real happy.
No, you're going to have monitoring on this, and you're going to have maintenance on it.
What are you going to do with the poplars that were part of the replication area? Right in the line of sight.
There were actually poplars planted in a replication area?
There is
a stand of poplars, that's what I'm looking at.
Stand of poplars?
Yeah, they're there. I'm not sure they were planted or required there.
Are you
Let
sure?
the record show that I didn't spec a stand of poplars in a replication area. I'd like to cut them, but if they're part of the design for the replication area.
I don't know. I'm asking.
Did that.
Back then we approved it.
Absolutely.
No, poplars aren't an invasive species. The state hasn't listed them. Or for that matter, staghorn and sumac. They're just a nuisance.
So what are your concerns?
My concerns are, if those were approved as a replication and now they want to cut them down, and the same thing, well, I don't know how they got in there, but they're all open. There's a ton of them in there.
They are new since that thing was built.
I never saw those. Yeah.
And I'm guessing it's the same over there, but I can't say for absolutely sure. I know we didn't spec that Phragmites in there.
No.
What's the date on that plant, if you can read it?
The one that
appears to call for stand up poplars.
It just shows it.
Ah,
that's your plan.
This is on your progress plan.
Oh, okay. So that may
that's
be
what I'm looking at.
Yeah, we've got some of the old Hayes design plans, and we can pull them on.
Community benefit trail plan? Like, if we're talking a 5 to 10 fee, would the community benefit be on top of that? Or would it be included in that fee?
Oh no, it would be on top
okay,
of that.
So then what if, this is just a suggestion, but what if we consulted with Trails Committee, had them go walk it, see if there's gonna be an extensive amount of boardwalk needed to see if it's even feasible for them to even consider a trail as the community benefit, just to see if they were like,
sure,
it's going to cost 50, it's going to cost 20, it's going to cost 5, just to get an idea of what we might charge them, or if even that's the community benefit we want to go with.
That's a good idea.
I think that would be kind of partly what you're saying, where if we talk to them, then we can kind of give you guys a better idea of what we might think it would be, sort of thing.
That's a good idea.
Because as we were talking about, like, they don't think it's going to be enough, but I doubt they were consulted on that. So I think that that's just me, but.
Where's the trail supposed to go? From Village Street down into this area?
From Bolden.
So.
Which you can get to from Main Street. And there's a sewer easement to get down there. Kim Heinrichslager gave us a map showing the sewer easement. Kind of on the north side of the stream.
Oh, so over here?
Yeah.
Right.
Well, it can takes Main Street over to Lorbe's Brook, that's it. If I understand Trails Committee.
All right. Anything else from the commission? Any other questions?
Well, let me tell you what the plan is right now. We have to advertise in the Environmental Monitor 14 days before a hearing. I believe that the actual language of the regulations is we have to advertise 14 days before filing.
Yeah.
The plan is.
These regulations apply to the new
The
new wetland restoration regulations.
Right. So let's say that we go for the 30th next week and we advertise in the Environmental Monitor and we file 14 days following that. Or we file a little before that, but we don't schedule a hearing until 14 mm-hmm. days mm-hmm. at least after that. We're looking at July mm-hmm. and we're looking at paying a local filing fee on the occasion of that filing. We don't want any assurances, really, because there aren't any assurances. This thing could be appealed by a citizen. This thing could be mm-hmm. appealed by DEP. It could all go in the toilet because the economy goes. So what we want is to know, what's filing fee going to be? So we can hand you a check, pay for the newspaper ad, get this thing filed.
$25,000. That's average. I figured I'd throw that out there. I have nothing to base it on, but I could carve it up nicely. But
that would be nice, but it's too much.
It's not too much. It's what? If the project that you have in, you know, a trail project, if looking at where that's going to go is going to be a lot of boardwalk, that could be upwards around $10,000 worth of material that's needed. Throughout that spot. So that's kind of a real number.
Yeah, but we wouldn't pay for that boardwalk out of the filing.
I don't think you can.
Well, no, we're the $25,000, again, my concept is to have a number and then break it into certain bits. So.
I don't know if we can do that at this
stage.
I don't think at the filing stage we can require X number of feet of trail. I think that becomes part of either
Well,
the
we can accept a filing fee of $5,000 and then add $10,000 for the trail and then ask for the rest in a bond, and that comes out to $25,000.
Well, the bond is totally different. The bond might be $50,000, but they get that back. The bond should be related to the construction cost of the improvements. Mm-hmm. So if they're proposing $100,000 of improvement and they go through and they spend $10,000 and then they go bankrupt and leave all their equipment in there and a pile of junk in there, we use that bond to get that equipment out and drag out all the junk that they didn't get out. That's what the bond's for. And then what?
But would that bond go like 10 years out?
It could. There would
the
be monitoring? It would be unusual, but it could. What we frequently do is have a sizable bond, and then every year or at every milestone, we release it. And then sometimes, some of these developers, it's down to a few thousand dollars, and they get tired, and they just walk away and leave. But usually after 3 or 4 years, it's all returned. But this might be longer.
But that's not part of the filing fee, though.
No,
that's down the road.
That's imposed as part of the order of conditions, as is a requirement for a trail. And that trail, Chuck, could either be give the town money to build the trail
or build it
yourself.
If it even is a trail.
It could be either.
Even if it is going to be a trail, I mean, it might be something else. So
could be something else.
So
could be a skateboard park.
How do we get to the filing fee is the question.
I've given my thoughts, but I'm open to anybody else's. I think that $400,000 means we don't have a project. I think $1,000 is way too low, so we've narrowed it some. It's between $1,000 and $400,000. And I think between 5 and 10 is is reasonable based on the size of this property and that alteration, but that's opinion and
so
arbitrary.
So what about the fee that they presented as a filing fee?
I would just like to see it based on something rather than just 1%. But again, that's personal opinion.
I mean, the basis can come later. I'm saying, you know, when they file, we need to come up with a fee for them to file.
Yeah, pretty much it has to be by agreement. Because it's essentially, right. It's a waiver of some
it's
of your fees, Charger.
We would be setting a precedent. And if we say the precedent is 1% of the full filing fee, could be getting yourself in trouble.
Well,
if we say it's a negotiated rate per square feet of wetland enhancement, then we could carry that precedent and change that negotiated fee based on
so
the project.
So we get back into it. We get back into the number.
If they're making a huge improvement, the fee would be very little per square foot, or maybe even zero. Whereas if the improvement is marginal, it could be a larger fee. But at least we set the precedence based on the number of square feet that you have activity.
All right, so as far as a filing fee number, does the number that they presented, regardless of how they came up with it, does that seem, for the filing fee, not for anything else, does that seem like a reasonable amount?
It was $4,700?
Yes.
$4,714.73. That's 1%.
I think it's a little low.
I think it's a little low, but I think 10 times it would be a little high.
Right. Now we need to back into a number that's somewhere in that vicinity, I think, for a filing fee. We have to calculate it. If that's the way we want to go. Maybe we don't want to do that. Maybe, you know, I mean, what is the sense of the commission? I know your... I think it makes sense as well, to, based on your reasoning, to have this, you know, square foot amount.
And linear foot of bank opened up,
right.
Amount.
Right.
You add those together and you come up with about $7,000, and I'd be happy.
So at about 10 cents per square foot,
okay.
Because
that's
this is
pretty close to there.
Yeah.
Just for the, and then we've got the other items that the $1,000, we were listing the number out.
Right.
And so we've got added on to that. So that's essentially $4,200 just for the wetlands area.
$1,000 your fixed fee. You
fixed
have to
fee.
Pay your $1,000.
So
right.
And then there were some other.
And then some bank alterations for another $1,000 or $2,000. And we're right close to
we're right where the number we want to be at. We're
okay.
All thinking.
All right. I think that works.
Don't know if it works. Got to talk to my client. $1,000. $900-something for the bank alteration.
Yep.
Can we prorate the bank alteration based on actual alteration, or are we talking about any activity in the bank?
I think prorated on the actual alteration, have the full amount where we're actually opening up the bank, and then some lesser amount when we're doing nothing but using the weed wrench to pull at the roots.
Okay. And 10 cents a square foot per wetland alteration.
I think it makes sense.
Work the numbers up, talk to my client, see what the long-term monitoring is going to cost him, because I've got to charge him something to do that, making reports for you. And that'll give you an idea of what the bond's going to require.
Don't you have an obligation to DEP as well?
We have a $500 filing fee.
No, I'm talking about monitoring, of course. Do they go?
Generally not.
No?
Only if DEP steps in and issues a superseding order. Again, we don't have any control over that. This is new to DEP, too. The only other ones they've done like this, as far as I'm aware, are either after the fact notices of intent for gross alteration or their DEM DCR plans, which, you know, those are mostly salt marsh irrigation, that sort of thing.
What about the one that Kraft did at the stadium?
Oh, daylighting the river.
Yes,
yeah.
Neponset River.
Yeah.
I was involved with that. That cost them over $1 million.
I'll bet it did.
That.
Yeah.
Do you know if they paid you?
I don't.
We're never going to rent any office space to the Patriots. I can safely say that.
Probably
bad,
a good thing.
Huh?
Probably a good
yeah,
thing.
Really.
I got something to work with here.
Okay.
They were required to do that.
No, they were not.
They offered it.
Yes, they actually, Rizzo did it, and
yeah,
they had
Rizzo
to kind of twist around Jonathan's arm. But
they also had a gray water system in the men's room, according to Ed Ionata.
I don't know about that.
Never been there.
Well, I would also...
Ed talked to him.
Right.
Yeah.
So 5 to 7.
It's my understanding, though, and please, if somebody else has a different understanding, speak up now. If he submits a notice of intent and a check for $7,000, and we do not vote, majority vote, to reduce the fee to that $7,000, he gets his money back.
I think that makes sense. I don't know how that works.
I guess we wouldn't accept the application, so we wouldn't accept the check.
I don't know
right,
how else
right,
you could vote
right,
on that.
Right,
you know,
right.
But
right.
Except by refusing the filing.
Right, exactly. Right. I mean, it seems that we work through that amongst us, and it's the consensus. Seems to be the consensus anyway, so...
Chuck, do you remember for Austin Prep, did they give us a check and we gave it back to them?
I don't know what it was, but yeah, you did give a lot of that back. Camp Curtis Guild, it was the 18, almost 19,000, but you reduced it to 13,000. Camp Curtis and then Austin Prep, I don't know, but a lot of that fee did go back as a nonprofit. I think all of it went back, as a matter of fact. We even wanted to return...
No, they did pay something.
The minor project,
yeah.
The minor plan fee, and then they decided not to go through that.
No, they did. They did pay some amount of money. I think it.
They paid the state fee, I think. Yeah, they waived the fees. I remember that's what they looked for.
Okay. So we're good. Okay.
Very much appreciated.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time. Sorry to keep you so late.
Thank you.
We've been here.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Have any questions?
Ma'am?
Any comments?
Dude, do you have any comments or questions? I apologize for not asking.
No,
comments.
I'm all set, thanks.
Okay, good.
So, what is the process from here on out?
Okay, so what they're proposing is to file a notice of intent,
mm-hmm.
Which basically is filing with the state. It's slightly different for what they're doing. It's a new process. They're going to advertise in the Environmental Monitor, but it's basically the same. File with the state, file with us, and what that entails is notifying the abutters officially with certified mm-hmm. return receipt of the date and the time of the hearing, which will be here,
mm-hmm.
And they'll present their official plan in a public meeting where the public will be able to comment
mm-hmm.
And be able to see the plan and provide comments on that plan. And then the commission makes a decision based on the presentation, based on the community input and the benefit to the community, as we talked about tonight. And we render a decision, whether we reject the plan, ask for changes. It's all based on all the input from the consultant and the community and how it relates to the wetlands laws and regulations.
And that can't occur until at least 2 weeks after they file the notice of intent with the state, correct?
With the Environmental Monitor, they have to publish their intent to file this notice of intent.
Yeah.
14 days after that publication, after that advertisement is taken out, they can have the hearing. We can schedule the hearing.
So they can't do it tonight, obviously. So the earliest would be 14 days from tomorrow.
Correct. And generally, if I'm correct, I think the Environmental Monitor only advertises on the 15th. And the last day of the month. So if they don't get it in by the 15th, which they didn't, they're going to have to get it in by the end of the month. and then it comes out 15 days later, I think it is. I forget.
So that hearing wouldn't be till probably the
second meeting in July.
Second or fourth week in July.
Right. So the earliest they could have that meeting, if they put the advertisement in today, it's not going to be published. The earliest they could have the meeting is the second meeting in July,
which would be like July
22nd
or 3rd, or
I think 22nd.
So Wednesday the 8th is the first meeting.
Then the 15th.
22nd is the, so the 22nd would be the earliest that that meeting could occur.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. Do we have an emergency permit to talk about? Or is that just a general item on the list?
Yeah, it's just a general item.
Okay. Administrator's report?
Have some minor projects to talk about, most important.
Ah, I missed that at the top.
Just pass this around, I'll talk about it. This is Pineville. A gentleman from the Trails Committee went out there and he saw chairs and a table and some candles and a fire pit.
In Pineville?
In Pineville, yeah. It was
on the trail?
On the trail. There's a trail map there with an X on it, if anyone knows Pineville well enough. It was like
between the white trail and the... We cleared it up. My son was 12. That was 13 years ago.
It's not where the leave pile is it?
No. No, it's not.
Wow, I guess the heck there is chairs there. Holy smokes.
Who from the Trails Committee?
Let me see what I got here.
And a rocking horse as well. Interesting.
There is some conservation land back there, but there's also some private land.
Yeah, they had to carry that a far away. What the heck?
John Parsons. He wasn't happy.
Thank you.
So it looks like it's going to get cleaned out by Jeff Zager. This is just looking at the email. Added a few.
So this is a minor project? This is a minor project?
No.
Oh, I was going to say, why would it be a minor project?
It's nothing. I'm showing it to you because Pineville is a conservation area.
Right.
And someone's in there making a home.
Right.
Making camp, or I don't know what they're making, but there's something out there, and I wanted to know what the commission would like to do about it.
Clean it out. Okay. That's what I would like.
Send it up the line.
Yeah.
Get somebody to...
I mean, it sounds like the DPW is going to take care of it, right?
There's a sewer back there.
They're just going to take a look. And they'll do some next steps at this moment. So yeah, Pineville. You'll also notice that it's pretty. That's a pretty heavy desk. And
yeah, and it's far in there. It's not like right off the end of a street somewhere. You know. It wasn't one person that did it. You can tell that.
It's not one person hanging.
Exactly.
Or it was one big person, and we weren't confronted.
Yeah.
This seems like something that. Just clean up. It's really, this, in my opinion, would be hard to figure out who did. You know,
yeah, I don't think this
doesn't really matter. You asked me last week if 28 Summer Ave was at least 50 feet away, and
yes.
I determined that it was at least 50 feet away with the work he did.
I think it's 26A Summer Ave, I think.
He has 28 on here in his application, so he believes it's 28 summer.
But it's the right house, right? It's down the one down and back.
It's the one behind 26.
Yes, it's one down and back.
Down and back.
Down and back.
It's
and
the only one
so
down.
When you look out the front door, you're looking straight at a house.
Yeah, it's the only one down there.
So 104 Scotland Road.
First, Jamie says Scotland Yard.
Scotland Yard. 104 Scotland Road is going to put in a. Is going to put in a above ground pool with a deck. We issued him this plan. And he is 70 to 80 feet away from where I think the wet resource area is, off the existing lawn. So I'm going to issue this minor project permit for a deck more than 50, for a pool and deck.
It is
more than 50 feet away.
It is in lawn.
It's directly behind his house.
Sounds good to me.
I mean, this shows where it's going. I don't know if that one did.
Pretty far out. Is that an isolated wetland too?
Yeah, it is. It's
just a bigger market, sort of thing.
Yeah, I mean that's a small isolated wetland.
Yeah.
Birch Meadow. We have it established a no-mow area. Probably a little bit bigger than what you've asked for, more than 10 feet, just because how the trees worked out. We staked it out. We talked to the guy that mows the lawn. Basically, they mow that lawn once a week. You must know that. They're saying, oh, people who use, Morton Field, people who use the field really like it, like close and manicured. So
once a week?
Once a week, yeah.
DPW?
I thought it looked great when we went there a week later, and they're like, no, this won't do at all.
DPW is doing that, or
recreation,
or
I think, right?
Cemetery.
Oh, but
right.
Whoever does, yeah. So cemetery does all the mowing.
Didn't say once a year.
Once a week.
A year? We approve once a year.
No. Field. The actual
field. Like outfield of the baseball field.
Oh.
They're not going to mow the no touch zone ever.
Right.
That's gone. They lost that. Unless they come in and there's a problem, then we have to address that problem, but otherwise it wouldn't happen. I did give you guys an email saying that they're going to stop planting in the fall. They're not, because Bob Keating recommends with the arborvitae that we said would go in there, spring planting. Because
really?
He's worried about last winter was so cold. If you plant them in the fall, that wintering process will dry them out and they'll all be dead. And, we really don't want that to happen. And he knows what he's talking about.
It's
going to
be early spring because the heat in the summer.
That's what.
Will
I
got to
get, I don't even know who's doing the planting. John Halsey's kind of in charge of that. But I got to get them notice of. I mean, there was no plan to go out there anytime soon, but. Just let them know another year is going to be fine. Do you guys agree? I mean, it's... Bob Keating kind of knows what he's talking about.
Yeah.
They haven't put the bleachers in yet, have they?
No. We just did the pre-activity meeting about a week ago, and I was just out there on Tuesday, and nothing has happened still.
Why couldn't they put the plantings now?
They want to avoid the heat of the summer.
Yeah, the heat will... They won't make
so that July, August, you usually don't plant.
Irrigate that field more than field.
Yeah, but it stresses the veggie. You'd have to water it.
Yeah, you really have
you
to be
on
it.
Could do it, but it's better.
I'm not sure. I mean, it's likely they're going to plant them and forget about it.
Exactly.
And I don't know. I didn't check out where the irrigation was or went. Same field. They're going to put in 4 light poles. 3 of them are more than 50 feet away. One of them is directly in front of that bleacher area at Morton Field where they're moving. One is center field heading towards those other fields where the DPW or the mowing crew continually get from field to field. There's kind of like an access path, but it might be grass. They're going to put one there. It's 28 feet away from the wetland.
Which wetland? Castine Field?
Is it the casting field on that side of it? It's Morton Field, and then just beyond it is casting field, so it's that tip where just before it goes into the culvert. That's where, or where it starts.
Corner.
Yeah, the corner. So,
left corner.
It's from center to right.
Okay, I'm just trying to...
Center to right on Morton Field. I'll put it up on the screen.
So they're within the 35-foot setback?
For one of these. So my question is for exploratory borings on an existing field, are they filing a notice of intent to move this project forward? Okay, because in your minor project permit, it says 50 feet away from my, so any, we should modify that to any exploratory borings.
No, exploratory borings are excluded from needing to file.
But not, but they're mentioned in the minor project permit, they have to be 50 feet away.
What?
Which would make you think that if they're closer than 50 feet, there's another permit needed.
Right.
What people do sometimes, which I applaud, is they file for the whole project and include
then
the boring as
yeah.
part of the project.
Well, they can't design it and even figure out. So the town works differently, as you know, everyone at town meeting. They need to understand how much money to ask for, and they need to do the borings first.
Approved it.
Did they really?
Absolutely. So if he's telling you that.
John Feudo told me they need to do this step so they can get to the next step.
Have we approved the money at town meeting?
Are they replacing a light tower? It looks like the light tower is already there, or am I looking in the wrong area?
They didn't say anything about replacing.
They're taking, I think, the ones that are there and putting them on Cascade Field.
I guess it's six of one, half dozen the other anyway, so.
I guess they should be faster with this.
If you're digging a hole, you're digging a hole.
Is that it?
We approved a light pole close to the wetlands at the football field. Damn light bulb fell in the wetlands.
Right there.
Because they didn't do the geotech.
So we can turn this on.
And not only the light bulb, but the damn concrete thing that was leaning
over.
It was bad news.
They probably use the standard base. Just put that in, it'll be fine.
She's letting them do that? She's like, right in my backyard.
No, it's not her. It's on Dana's. It's on Dana's property.
So they're letting them.
A couple?
As a young guy? As a young guy with market basket bags walking past me in that area. I'm wondering if he's
I don't know, because I know a lot of people do walk, take shortcuts through there when they do the shopping.
Maybe
they live on
like
Washington Street
Yeah, but it was on the wrong
Anyone
side.
See that?
He wasn't on the sidewalk side.
Is that walkable? Is it where
it is.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a beaten path there. Yeah.
That's basically where we're doing it.
Whoa.
Here.
That's right next to the Arbogena River.
That's the one.
Yeah. Is that the headwaters of the Arbogena right there?
It's actually up by the football field.
The mowing crew goes straight through here all the time. If they put it there, it's on existing lawn.
Yeah, but it looked, it's pretty damn close to that channel.
I'm looking for direction.
I think they need to be 35 feet away. Or file a variance and explain why they can't be 35 feet away. It's only 7 feet.
So are they putting a light in the 1 foot radius?
With that little...
Where, like,
I'm just guessing, but see that little point right there?
No, I meant the other ones. Like, are those where the other lights are going? So it's like a weird thing. It's not a field.
Yeah.
Like, they're not even getting all of it.
In the outfield next. Well, I think they need to direct this one towards the pitching area here.
But I'm not talking
I guess they're trying to use the spillover from the turf and the tennis courts for a corner.
So you'd like to see John Feudo here next meeting to request a variance,
or
not under a permit, just
move it 35 feet. I mean, we have to be careful with the town applications.
Mm-hmm.
If we let the town build within 35 feet and we're strict on residents and don't allow them, that is a big problem.
So you're talking about putting it over here?
Move it 7 feet.
There?
Probably just move it 7 feet.
This is where the ropes course is for the high school.
You don't have to move it 7 feet.
So just like more in the corner?
See where the where the 15 is? Just put it there.
So we need 35 feet away right in here. It's pretty much 35 feet away if they just moved it.
Well, you said 28. You only got to move 7 feet.
So from the bank, if they can get 35 feet away, you're good.
Well, I mean, they would need a variance.
They still need a variance. All right.
No, they would
they
not
would
need
not.
A variance.
Okay. Okay.
But what you're asking is, do they have to file an RDA or?
No, no.
Intent?
Well, I was just told before we turned this on that you never need anything for exploratory borings.
That's
so
correct.
We were going along with that,
that's
but
correct.
Now we need a variance
for that location.
For the light.
It's based on 35 feet, and yeah, I get that now.
But if they're going to do a boring, they should
do it
where they're going to put the light. I'm not a geotech engineer, but that makes pretty good sense to me.
What was that last part? They should put it where? Where
they
at the
put
proposed
the
location.
Where
the
location is.
So if we know we're going to, they either have to file for a variance and or move it 35 feet. If they just choose to move it 35 feet, they're going to want to just put the boring at that
put
location.
Put the boring there.
And if there's a reason to have it at that location, then that's fine. They can do the boring. They can come in and ask for variance and tell us why they need a variance.
Elson, you don't think they can move it 7 feet?
No, I'm where they chose to put it. I'm sure the softball team is like, I don't want a huge light pole right where I'm pitching, because like the fence is pretty close there. So I'm sure that they were like, you need to move it over here, because they can't just build it there without consulting with it. With the softball commission, whatever it's called. But I'm sure we can definitely ask them to do that. I mean, there's no harm in asking, you know? And if they come back, then we can have a discussion. But are you guys going to have a discussion?
I'd hate for them to put the boring in there and then not get approval and have to put it somewhere else. And
no, that's what I'm saying. We should tell
board.
Them to
yeah.
Like move it there, but if they come back, then that's it. Discussion.
That makes sense.
All right.
So there you go.
Go over it again, because
35 feet.
And they're fine.
And they're fine.
The rest of them are fine. We're only talking about this one. The rest
right.
of them are like 50 plus.
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
like
yeah.
67 feet over here by the bleachers. So. And do you want to change the minor project criteria? It says 50 feet. Boring, so we could drop that down to 35 feet.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, that's fine.
And under the state regulations, it's not even required. You don't
no,
have to
it's not.
Boards, right.
It's required, yeah.
But 35 feet makes sense for us.
Okay. So can you take a vote to reduce the
yes.
minor project permits criteria for borings to 35 feet?
I move that we reduce the minor project criteria specifically for borings from 50 feet to 35 feet.
Second.
All those in favor?
Okay, he'll probably be able to do that. So this is like two different, like there's a baseball people
well,
and then there's
dirt
the...
Is right
oh
now.
Yeah, I recognize
that's
that.
That's the softball field, and the softball field is close to that fence, to the outfield fence is the problem. So I'm not sure if the softball people are going to be annoyed having a huge lead pole right next to their dugout, right in between where they walk back there. Because there's space, but there's not like. I'm assuming that they probably.
Let's look at that field. I'm just going to give you my opinion in a second.
There are light poles out there
nice
now.
Field.
Or take care of that.
What, softball? Oh,
on
yeah,
that other field.
That's the varsity softball field, and they use that all the time.
No, on Morton
softball.
Field.
On this field, yeah.
Yeah, but on Morton
field. Like that
field
already has lights.
Oh. I don't think so.
They use that field more than they use Morton field.
Oh, I thought there was one in the middle of the field somewhere.
They use Morton field at night, don't they?
And they have lights.
I'm thinking of, yeah, I'm thinking
they use the softball field for the whole guy's softball games.
I thought Morton field.
So it's on the agenda about I need you to approve some fees and
yes, bills.
Does everyone think that the 700 plus fee for MACC getting kind of steep?
They raise their fees, huh?
Yeah, just you know, just by mean annual income. And so you know, being curious, I checked it out. Boxford, 120,000. Arlington, 110,000, and here was 88. I was very surprised. 88,000. Mean annual income.
In Reading.
Yeah. But there's other factors that go into it. It's a black box, and they throw some things in there. We come out with 700 something dollars. But I did, you know, so I don't know why I'm like this, but then I said, you know, what are we really doing? Who really reads the, you know, with the newsletter, it's online. There's a lot you can get just by going to their site. And is the benefit we're getting, the $700+, how many people go to the MACC conference? Because you do get a reduction on that. It's probably not.
In my mind, the benefit is to have it there if we need it. And when we redid the bylaws, we relied on them heavily. We rely on them to track the DEPs to the weapons. It's to have them cover our back. To me, that's the benefit.
No, I agree, and I actually started out at MACC, so I wouldn't want to chip them out, but just to, you know, it can't be $1,000. It can't be 1500 some year, you know? It seems...
So I move that we pay the Water Street and Sewer... the Water and Sewer bill on Pearl Street, $11.83.
Second.
All those in favor? And that's a vacant lot.
That's way too much.
Okay.
No.
Do you know that we actually did some research on that and found out that we've been paying way too much for many years, and that's part of a little bit of a reduction of what's left of it. So we'll probably go up around $26 next time we see that.
And I believe most of that's a stormwater fee, is that correct?
It's all stormwater.
Yeah.
So it goes back into the enterprise fund,
right.
Stormwater. I mean, it's our money.
We get a new Vactor truck, a second one. Anyway, and I move that we pay the Massachusetts Association of Conservation Commission's annual dues for $764.
Second.
All those in favor?
We're big spenders.
Okay. What else you got, Chuck? Oh, minutes for approval.
So we're taking over, go over that. We're taking over Matera Cabin soon, very soon. And there's already some damage to the floorboards heading into the front area. So it
from
has
the ice?
Yeah, from the ice, from the fact that it's not pressure treated and it's a slope that hits the, the decking. And that decking's only 4 foot wide. So it has to be maintained, so we're seeing if facilities can take care of it.
A tree fell on one of those benches and crushed it. Did you see that?
I was...
You were sitting
just
on
just to try to get facilities to do this, the amount of emails I had to do was just crazy. And so many times it just felt like, give me a key, let me rummage through the garage,
right.
And if there's any wood there, I'll just bring my tools in, you know?
So, minutes, were there any changes or comments on the minutes?
Yeah.
I had a few suggestions.
Okay, go ahead.
On page, I think it's the first page under Indiana Road. Did I send
you? Yeah,
I
sent it to everybody, but I printed it out or added changes.
I'm just suggesting we add the sidewalk on the side of the house was not installed. And then I had one on, I think it's page three.
I've got a couple on the second page. What is this?
Oh, I don't know. I'll get that out of there, that little symbol.
And then Tom Walsh, 532 Pearl Street, last sentence.
I have something on the third page. Under general way, the third sentence, as currently written, reads, the problem is the local bylaw fee, which was designed so that changes would not be made. The local bylaw fee is not designed to prevent infringement on the wetlands. It might accomplish that as a byproduct, but it has never been said, agreed, or put in writing that that's the purpose. So I think we should just strike that part of the sentence and just leave it. The problem is the local bylaw fee, period.
I also have something on that. John Hick is actually John Dick. And I think, wasn't he talking about the approximate budget as of 50,000, not 40,000?
I believe he did say it was 50.
Yeah, I too.
And now tonight he said it might be 50 to 100.
Gee, that's a change there.
So it'll be 200 by filing.
Pardon me?
I said it's just going to go up another X amount by filing.
And then I had a couple suggestions on that next paragraph, paragraphs between two areas of the project. Okay, the first is in the 1, 2, 3, 4th line, the sentence that begins on that 4th line. They propose to clear out understory and then add and breach the dike in several locations to allow water to flow in and out. And then in the next sentence, an edit to read, approximately 60% of the flora are invasive species and they would be removed. One more, I think, on the last page. Do you have any more records?
Yeah, I do. On the next page, Ms. Snyder Walker met with Jody Hayward and is in favor of the improvement project and is willing and would improvement project and would like the applicant to consider a trail included with the project. And then
leaf, yeah,
leaf. It's leaf.
Leaf. Okay.
Yeah,
that. I think
yep. Oh, the next page would no.
I don't remember the last page.
On Caliaco West Street, the last sentence. Everything was taken seriously.
That wasn't our meeting.
What?
That must have come from another meeting.
What does that mean?
Supposed to do?
I don't.
What?
West Street enforcement order?
I would just take that out. I mean,
yeah,
that doesn't make.
Yeah,
that might have been said, but it.
Yeah.
I might have. I don't even know if it was said, but that's not minutes worthy.
And then 26
okay.
Summer Ave. The project's basically finished. The board may have to go back to the original filing for this property to determine the location of the wetland.
Yeah, good.
That's it.
On the last page, election. It says Ms. Cannon reported committee commission bylaws to be finalized at the end of July. I'm not sure what we mean there. I think what was said, and I wish the name was here, Ms. Cannon reported elections would be held by the end of July.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Well, they actually have to be finalized, so maybe she said they have to be final. We only have until the end of July to
have an election.
Be done.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so you would expect that it would be the first meeting in July, not so to finalize it, or at least the discussion. I don't know how it would
so
work.
So the discussion will have to happen next meeting because she's not here right now. So I think it makes sense for the chair to be here.
I would say that she would probably, I mean, the courtesy has been extended to other people on the committee, so.
Right.
I'm sorry, say that again.
She's the chair and she should be here.
That same courtesy has been extended to other people on the committee. That when they're not here, we wouldn't take a vote like this.
Right. So Ms. Scanlon reported elections had to be finalized by the end of July.
Right.
I think that would be.
I think that was
yeah.
what she said.
So that's that.
That's all I have. So
and
I move we approve the minutes as amended.
Second that.
All those in favor? Okay.
I just have one more thing. I just thought you would be interested in how much is in the just our budget. And year to date, it's $6,312. And in January, we'll be asked to do an offset for $4,000, which we have done for the past 3 years. And that offset is to supplement my salary. I don't know if that's exactly what they do, but we asked for an offset. So that's been dwindling. I think it started out around $15,000. When I first got here, there was no offset, and then it was 10 at the end of last year, and then we gave $4,000, and we've had six, and we've only brought in $1,700 into this fee, and this is the state portion of the fee, the part we control.
Right.
We don't control the bylaw fee, so when you guys give that money away, it's just only going into the general fund anyways. It's not like we can buy a new bench or take care of a Terra Caravan or something like that.
Right. And if One General Way had paid $400,000, we would not have seen anything.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, yeah.
We're going for enough policemen and a farm.
Yeah. Anyways, I just thought you might like to know where we're at with that kind of stuff. I have the rest of, you know, what's on, what we have for Matera Cabin, which is for any other thing you're interested in, Kirchie and Woods, all that, if you ever wanted to know.
So we have to pay water and sewer on Matera Cabin, right?
We will be. I passed that off to John, one of the first things I did. So we'll be paying water and sewer on that. And we're hoping to make some, not we're hoping, but we should look at that place and say, what do we want to use it for? And because you guys never really had the chance. It was given away as soon as you got it to be under other people's control. And to look at it and where do you want to go with this, the educational piece, how does that work? Maybe even parking, maybe even fire pit up on that side hill, something like that. Some things are not allowed, which we might
fire
want to review
pits
all
are
that.
Not allowed in life.
Yeah. No.
We have outdoor fires. If you get a one-time permit, none have been issued in 15 years, or if the outdoor fire is for cooking, you cannot have an open flame outdoor.
I will update you next.
I know.
Yeah.
Well, I'll update you on that next week. We actually had an application, a minor project permit, where a gentleman came in and said, look, I'm going to do this, and it has a fire pit in the center. So with our view permit system, we notify Greg Burns, who's the fire chief, and they have just, it was great when people use it. Not everyone's using it. Some people are manipulating it, but so he has to look at the new regulation somehow. So there's something new. He didn't automatically say no, which I was surprised.
Greg didn't?
No. Yes, exactly. Because I asked Paul Jackson 3 years ago,
right,
and he said, no, they're not allowed. I go, what if you throw a stake on it? He said, no, I can't do that. So
they
there's a change.
They came into my yard and told me they weren't allowed.
Well, you live right next door to the fire department.
Is there a provision for gas?
Gas is okay.
Yeah.
And for
imagine
cooking
that.
Is okay.
Well,
cooking is okay.
Yeah, but I'm...
A gas fire, I think, is okay, but don't...
Yeah.
Don't go Bill with
yeah, so... Well, anyways, Matera,
Do you think we make enough money, or is John?
It's close to just offsetting the what actually we pay in, you know,
water,
maintenance.
Water, electricity.
Well, it's we're getting about $2,000 right now, you know, plus or minus a couple hundred, and I think it costs about $2,000 plus or minus a couple hundred to run it.
Yeah.
But, you know, when you look at it, it's not perfect. There's, you know, it needs some sort of sealer on the outside of this thing, which would be a great scout project. That's what they do to log cabins. It has that problem in the front that I told you about, where the deck is rotting. You know, you can't let that go because that's just right there.
Yeah.
You know, when you step on it and you have a high heel on it, something like that, you're going to go right through. It's going to be a problem. But everything has...
It's a problem for you, not for me.
Everything creates a different problem, because if we work on the deck and we do
walk in high heels, Chuck is still practicing.
Okay, it's getting late.
So if we do any work on that walkway, that boardwalk, we have to make it ADA compliant, which is a much bigger project than replacing two boards.
I thought that ramp was ADA compliant.
It might be ADA compliant down to the entrance deck, but there's a step up into the cabin.
Yeah, that's not ADA compliant.
And I don't even know if that 3-foot wide deck is, I mean, it can't work. I mean, if it doesn't have a screen door, as a matter of fact, but if it did, that would be a problem.
Right. So, do we have to wait for the recording secretary to come back to go to friends and family day?
Oh, I wish no, we don't.
Okay.
No. I was going to say, if this was off, we could make some funny comments, but no.
So, I friends and family day debrief. I think it went pretty well. I was there for probably half of it anyway, the later half. And what is that turtle's name? I must have got asked that 15 times.
Not named.
I named it Chris.
I can't believe he's not named, or she's not named.
No.
That was disturbing. Do we have to do that again?
That turtle spent it the whole time.
Oh my God.
That was awful.
I'll tell you this much. If the turtle goes there, don't go with Rebecca. She won't stop with the turtle.
That poor thing.
He's trying to get out, yeah. He's trying to get out the whole time. Let me out. But other than that, it went well. I had a few people stop by that might be interested in maybe serving on the commission.
I got a card from a lady from the Hallmark Health System, Barbara Musselman, and she said she was looking or trying to help different organizations in Reading to get, you know, volunteers. And I said, well, I'll take your card. So have you talked?
I was standing there when she was talking, but
what do you think?
I thought it was great. I thought she was offering, I don't know, pre-canned seminars on environmental stuff. Is that, that's what I thought it was.
Oh, it's not helping trails or something?
I thought she was, really?
It sounds familiar to me. I think I talked to her last year.
I think we talked about it.
Yeah.
So maybe it'd be worth a phone call, but just to find out what is going on.
But it was pretty good. I mean, I have a great time every year. But I did have some pretty good conversations with a couple of people who seemed to be very interested in possibly serving on the commission. And I encouraged them to contact you fill out the form online.
Yep.
I meant to bring forms with me.
Oh, that.
But I didn't. I didn't have them, so.
Right.
But, you know, the weather was good.
It was good, and I think for me what it turns into is everyone that's pulled the permit, they come up and they say hi, and, you know, you get to get some feedback. So I'm starting to know people, which
was
really good. The first thing I did when I got there, and I told everyone, but I didn't get a chance to tell Allison and Jamie, that I went right over to Home Depot, and I told them, I'm thinking of this project, and can they donate the amount of material? So the project is a deck on the back of Matera Cabin. So they need a plan, and I went to the engineering department thinking, you know, let's whip up a plan. I've done a plan before, just get a piece of paper, sketch it out, blah, 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 take some measurements. My vision was to go out there and see what's can be done, you know, on site. Hasn't had, you know, when was this, a couple weeks ago, still they want to go out there, take shots, and then draw our plan for me. So their survey guy has to go out. It's like, wow, so much. But it'll be a good plan, and I want to show up as something that Home Depot will know we're serious, and maybe I can get this deck. So does everyone think that moving forward with a project that would create a back deck on Matera Cabin, something I should pursue? Because my thought is the inside's very choppy. If it's an educational building and it's a good day, go outside with some picnic tables and have your class out there.
I think it's a good idea.
Yep.
I would like to start with the idea of having it out of that synthetic decking rather than pressure treated.
That's expensive.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, we talked about that.
Yeah.
You and I did.
Oh, I know.
I think it's the only way to go.
I think it is. I wish I'd done that.
Except for the mold. It's really good.
I don't have mold on mine, probably because it's in the sun. But
you can power wash the hell out of it.
One of the builders told me that there's a lawsuit, that's why he doesn't use it, on the mold that accumulates on the decks because of splinters. So I don't know what's decking splinters, if it's AZAC or whatever. But that was his thought. The other thing I did is I started talking to some of the builders, and I don't know if this is appropriate or not, but it was just brief conversations. Each of the two would donate their team for a day to
wow.
help on this project.
That's what Habitat does. Habitat
for
Humanity.
That's huge.
Exactly.
That's huge.
And Glenn Redman requires, he goes, who's going to, I have to talk to Glenn, and he said, who's going to build this? I'm worried about, you know, certain groups just not knowing what they're doing. So this would satisfy him completely.
Oh yeah.
So
that's fantastic.
It seems like there's a lot of things that can happen, and it starts with at least getting some material.
Yeah.
We just if anybody's interested, if you remember Imagination Station,
mm-hmm.
that was huge, and that was built with volunteer labor, but we had professional people as supervisors. Each professional person was given a crew, and we'd go out there and work Saturdays and Sundays for a year, basically, and we built the whole thing with volunteer labor. And we ended up tearing it down because the rats took over.
Yeah.
It was fun before that. Love that
yeah,
place.
You played on it.
I love that place.
Yeah, my kids did.
The rats took over?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Like, seriously, rats?
That plus the splinters were
no,
horrible.
No, it was impossible not to get a splinter.
Really?
Just you run your hand along the banister for 2 feet, you get, like, a huge one in your hand.
Oh, wow.
Oh, another thing while we're wasting time.
Really,
we didn't do any geotech, and they did a lot of blasting of rock for the high school, and they took those rock they blasted, and they put it there.
Oh.
So when we were digging for the post, we hit those damn chunks of rock they put in there.
Making it so much more fun.
Nobody cares
about you. That's right. I know that firsthand.
I have to.
Yeah. I know it at the Hancock building. Prudential building.
So, one final bit of business. This is Allie's last meeting. She's all done. You're moving out of town, is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Moving to Boston, huh? You going to get on the commission there?
that is so political.
Oh,
yeah, no,
boy.
Thank you.
Do you know Charles?
What do they have, like one wetland in Boston or something?
No, I know.
Well,
it's
harbor
and
all that.
I wouldn't do that.
He was the chairman.
That would be, like, sketchy.
So what's...
I think you get a bit sketchy. Yeah, really.
The big move to Boston is just to get closer to school, or...?
No, it's just to, like, live with my friends. Get out of my parents' house.
Idea. I wish I had done that. Gone to live in the city, but I didn't. So I think that's, we're gonna miss you.
Yeah, we are.
We are. Thank you for serving.
What part of Boston?
I get a job
in
Reading.
What part of Boston?
Alston, Brighton Line.
Oh yeah, I remember those days. I was right there, Twin Donut, man.
Good place. I've been there.
Have you?
Yeah.
Still there?
Still
there.
The Canvara.
Newberry Street for $300 a month.
Come on.
On Newberry Street.
Wow.
I'm getting that now.
Unbelievable. Yeah, we're gonna miss you.
It sounds like you're gonna get other people.
Yeah, I hope.
Well, we may fill your seat, but never the empty hole in our hearts.
And look at Becky, you might be back.
That was funny.
So, on that note,
I move we adjourn.
A second.
All those in favor?
You made it through your first meeting.
Yeah.
We've had some members that quit after their first meeting. So.
Yeah, actually, this wasn't a bad one.
My first meeting went to midnight.
Before 10 o'clock.
What?
My first meeting went to midnight. So.
It did joke. Oh, my God.
I wasn't at the one that went to 1 a.m.
I wasn't either.
Glad I missed that one.
That is, that is not allowed.
I was not at that one, and I heard it was good to not be at that one.
Then when they were building Home Depot, we used to go at midnight every time.
And we also had to meet every week.